Good morning, everyone. My name is Raj Madabushi. I am an Associate Director for Guidance and Scientific Policy in the Office of Clinical Pharmacology. I am also CDER's point of contact for the MIDD paired meeting pilot program. It gives me great pleasure to set the background for today's workshop. I will share with you agency's efforts under PDUFA 6 aimed at integration of model-informed drug development, also referred to as MIDD, in drug development and regulatory decision-making. Among other goals, PDUFA 6 reauthorization included several enhancements to support drug development and review in the form of regulatory decision tools listed here. Specifically, incorporation of benefit-risk assessments and patient voice into drug development and review. Increasing capacity to support data analysis standards and review of complex innovative designs. Enhancements of the drug development tools qualification pathway for biomarkers. And relevant for today, advancing model-informed drug development. We believe the stipulated performance goals under PDUFA 6 provide a framework for advancing MIDD in a holistic and an integrative manner. In brief, these goals are to develop regulatory science, review expertise, and staff capacity, to convene a series of public workshops to identify best practices, to conduct a pilot program for MIDD, to publish or revise relevant draft guidances on MIDD, and similarly, to develop or revise relevant policies and procedures as appropriate. Over the next few slides, I will provide an overview of the activities in this space, starting with MIDD paired meeting pilot program. The program is jointly administered by CDER's Office of Clinical Pharmacology and CBER's Office of Biostatistics and Epidemiology. The goal of this program is to provide a dedicated forum for regulatory interactions on MIDD-related issues. The commitments include granting 2 to 4 meetings per quarter. Granted sponsors get a pair of meetings over a span of 120 days to discuss application of MIDD approaches for their drug development related to dose selection or optimization, application of clinical trial simulation, and mechanistic safety evaluation. A Federal Register notice was published announcing the availability of the program in April of 2018, along with procedures for submission. A cross-center committee was established to review the meeting requests and inform the selection. The processes around the paired meeting program were developed and operationalized. A dedicated MIDD website was developed to help sponsors with the submission. Over the next two slides, I will share our experience to date. Starting with program by the numbers, I'm showing here the quarterly activity since the program was announced in 2018. You can see that we have either met or exceeded the stipulated quarterly allotment over the past 3 years. To date, we have received 42 meeting requests from 28 different sponsors. A third of the sponsors were repeat requesters, highlighting the value of the program. In total, we granted 35 meeting requests, of which 4 were granted as written responses only to accommodate the increased demand. Of note, our experience is limited as it pertains to immunogenicity assessments, and we are encouraging sponsors to consider this program for engagement on CBER-regulated products. When we look at the numbers a little bit more closely, we find the meeting requests not only span the different phases of drug development as illustrated in the pie chart, but also across different therapeutic areas, highlighting the broad applicability of the program. some of the outcomes from these meetings as it pertains to drug development include gaining alignment around the modeling and simulation approaches to inform trial design and patient selection, strategies for dose selection, optimization, and risk mitigation, identifying alternative approaches for therapeutic individualization and alignment on regulatory pathways for contexts such as approval of a new dosing and formulation. In addition to advancing specific drug development programs, to date, 4 regulatory approvals have been facilitated via the MIDD pilot program. These approvals have resulted in patient-friendly dosing options ranging from shorter infusion time to reduced hospital stay to extended interdosing interval and additional dose options as part of titration. A recent publication by sponsors who participated in the pilot described several benefits of this unique regulatory program. These include savings in development time and cost, alignment on complex drug development issues, and learnings that translated to other development programs. All these highlight the impact of MIDD in advancing drug development and review. Other activities beyond the pilot program under PDUFA 6 include providing clarity on regulatory expectations through guidances. We published a new guidance outlining the format and content expectations for physiologically based pharmacokinetic analysis. We also updated the guidance from 1999 on population pharmacokinetics. Ongoing activities include finalizing the population pharmacokinetic guidance, the standard operating procedures for conducting population pharmacokinetic analysis, and the revision of 2003 exposure response guidance. The PDUFA 6 commitments also include conducting 4 workshops. So far, we have conducted 2 workshops. The first aimed at developing best practices for design analysis and inference from dose exposure response studies, and the second, development of best practices for physiologically based pharmacokinetic modeling to support clinical pharmacology regulatory decision making. The third topic is disease progression model development, including natural history and trial simulation, which is planned for the fall of this year. And rounding out the commitments is today's workshop on immunogenicity and correlates of protection for evaluating biological products, including vaccines and blood products. So what is immunogenicity? Immunogenicity is defined as the ability of a therapeutic product to trigger an immune response in the body, and this response, depending on the product-specific context, can be either desired, such as in the case of vaccines and allergenic products, or undesired response, which is the case for biotherapeutic products and some small molecules. MIDD approaches may provide supportive evidence for safety or efficacy by predicting and assessing immunogenicity. Undesired immunogenicity is the propensity of the therapeutic protein product to generate immune response to itself and to related proteins, such as formation of anti-drug antibodies, or to induce immunogenically related adverse clinical events, such as hypersensitivity, anaphylaxis, or cytokine release syndrome. Protein engineering approaches involving the use of predictive algorithms and in vitro identification of immunogenic epitopes and their removal are often employed to de-immunize a protein. For cell and gene therapy products, which consists of many combinations of proteins and biomolecules, the complexity of manufacturing and mechanism of action make immunogenicity characterization of these products more complex. FDA has published several guidances to assist sponsors in assessing immunogenicity risks. Listed on this slide are 2 foundational guidances. The first, for assessing immunogenicity for therapeutic proteins, This guidance discusses product and patient risk factors that may contribute to immune response rates as well as risk mitigation strategies. The second provides considerations for development and validation of immunogenicity assays. The guidances for the development of biosimilars and interchangeables also include considerations for immunogenicity assessment. The guidance for demonstrating biosimilarity discusses determination of biosimilarity, which can include a comparison of clinical immunogenicity, while the guidance for demonstrating interchangeability discusses demonstration of interchangeability, which can include a switching study to evaluate if switching results in differences in immunogenicity. FDA has also published guidances pertaining to immunogenicity potential for certain generic drug products. The FDA guidance on immunogenicity-related considerations for low molecular weight heparin discusses an alternative approach to assess the effect of certain changes on product immunogenicity risk. The 2021 guidance on ANDAs for certain highly purified synthetic peptide drug products of rDNA origin discusses the identification, production, mitigation of risks related to peptide-related impurities, including immunogenicity risk. It should be noted that none of the guidances for the undesired immunogenicity discuss the role of MIDD approaches for assessing immunogenicity. Over the next two slides, we will look at desired immunogenicity. As stated earlier, immunogenicity can be a desirable attribute, for example, in the generation of an effective protective immunity against infectious pathogens. Specific considerations for the development of such products include identifying correlates of protection, surrogate endpoints for efficacy, and robustness of the immune response, such as longevity of antibodies and immune memory. Additional patient factors, such as whether the patient is immunosuppressed as in older adults, or the impact of maternal immune transfer in newborns, may play a critical role in the generation of an effective immune response. FDA has issued several guidances on the clinical development approaches to support biologics license applications for pandemic influenza vaccines, seasonal inactivated influenza vaccines, products developed under animal rule, and vaccines to prevent COVID-19. Of note, there exists a clear opportunity to clarify the role and value of MIDD approaches in informing the development of such products. And today's workshop presents a step in that direction. In today's workshop, over five sessions, we will hear from subject matter experts on MIDD application for immunogenicity assessment. The focus of the first session is a review of the current state of in silico methodologies used to evaluate immunogenicity, with specific emphasis on quantitative systems pharmacology modeling approaches for different disease contexts. The second session aims to discuss the available data resources and data needs for facilitating the application of MIDD approaches to evaluate immunogenicity at various stages of drug development. The range of data include in vitro, in vivo, and clinical data, including real-world data from electronic health records. The third session will focus on possible applications and limitations of MIDD approaches for desired immunogenicity of vaccine and allergenic products. This will feature exploratory approaches for tuberculosis, COVID-19, and other disease areas. The fourth session will discuss the unmet needs and provide insights into the possible future applications of MIDD in the context of immunogenicity, specifically with respect to opportunities and challenges in assessing immunogenicity of gene therapies. The fifth session will feature a roundtable discussion with FDA and industry representatives on the topics presented throughout the day. Without further ado, I will hand it over to Dr. Kimberly Maxfield, the host for session one, to start the proceedings and look forward to an exciting day of